afternoon, everybody. We're here for this panel. I know it's the last panel of the day, but in talking to my colleagues here that have joined, we're going to have a very informative and interesting and perhaps a provocative panel on the K-12 space and the supplemental education and the use of AI and big data. So my name is John Kim. I'm a senior lecturer at Harvard Business School, and I teach a class on entrepreneurship and innovation in the education space. And so I'm very privileged and honored to be here with all of you today. We have three guests. We have going down to my left is Chen Ningyu from Xueersi, and then Simba Zhang Simba from Wenba, and then we have Drew Geant from Wyzant. And so what we're going to do is I'm going to just kick it off with a very brief overview of this panel, and then each of them will introduce themselves and the service that they use. Tutoring and supplemental education is obviously a very large market. Some people estimate that it's about $100 billion market around the world, and a considerable amount of it is in China as well as in countries like India. And I think there are very many differences between these countries, for example, from the US and China. But I think one thing is certain, it's the way in which parents and students use to both make up if they're behind in their school, as well as to get ahead. And in doing so, there's a tremendous amount of data that is collected, and there's an opportunity to improve that tutoring and education to help students excel in school and reach their full potential. And given that importance, there's been a tremendous number of companies that have started in countries like China and India, as well as the US. And as these companies have progressed over the years, they have started to collect a lot of data. And most recently, we have seen them use this data to personalize and develop new innovative programs. So I think it's a very exciting time for this type of service. And we're very fortunate to have these leading entrepreneurs here. So with that very brief introduction, I'll hand it over to you for a brief introduction about your service.
各位嘉宾大家好, 我叫陈宁玉。 我来自这个侯未来集团的学而思网校 然后我们学而思网校呢 大概是08年创立吧 2010年呢 我们是正式上线 最早我们是做这个录播业务的 就是我们会把那个线下讲得特别好的老师 把他的视频录下来 然后放在网上进行这个教学活动 但是最近呢 应该是在3年前吧 我们就正式转型成这个直播 直播加辅导这个模式 我们的课程形式大概是一个
直播大班就是一对几百的一个直播大班，就这个老师像几百个学生同时讲授。那课后呢，会有一个辅导老师来负责每一个学生的这个作业批改以及这种答疑沟通。大概是这样一个形式。谢谢大家。大家好，我是学霸君张凯磊。我们大概在中国市场提供这样几块服务。第一个是拍题的服务，就是在任何时间，你在 K12 体系里面，你遇到题不会，一秒钟你拍给我们。 我们在一秒钟智能返回给你这道题目的这个答案跟解析。这个产品在中国市场里面现在有超过8000万的用户，2000万的阅读活跃用户。可以说中国1.8亿的中小学生可能一半是学霸君的这个用户。这块市场之外的话，我们另外提供另外一个叫答疑的这个服务。你也可以把它理解为叫滴滴打老师的这个服务。在任何时间，你可以呼叫到一个老师，然后帮你来解决你的 在作业里面的这个疑惑的这个问题，老师是直播的，然后以分钟进行计费，然后迅速解答你完这个问题，就迅速挂掉。同时，我们也提供直播的一对一的，跟一对三的这样的一些服务。 同时我们在今年的这时候呢，就说是进入了一批公立的这个学校，然后把我们的教育系统让公立的这个学校来使用，包括了整个的作业体系跟考试体系，然后包括自动批改，理科主观题的这个自动批改，在被我们攻克了这之后呢，我们现在能够向大量的学校提供整个理科体系的作业批改服务，然后并且采集大量的数据来指导教学，这是我们现在主要在中国提供的服务。
Hi everybody, my name is Drew Geant, and I am co-founder and CEO of Wyzant. We are a US-based tutoring marketplace that helps students of all ages connect with the perfect tutor across hundreds of different academic and professional subjects. And as a marketplace, we have tens of thousands of people come to our site every day looking for something very specific. And what sets us apart is our approach that kind of starts with the premise that tutoring is not a commodity product. So we don't attempt to prescribe a certain methodology or curriculum. We look at it as our job to help people find the right fit for them based on their specific circumstances and needs. And when you get that right, that's where we see very transformative sort of learning experiences. So that's how we use data. I'm sure that's what we'll be talking about more, is in trying to get that right fit between the tutor and the student. We have over 80,000 tutors in our marketplace. We've been around for 10 years, so lots of data that we can put to work.
Okay, great. Well, thank you for each of you for introducing your services. So let me ask a question to each of you. You know, when you think about tutoring, even this morning, people said, Confucius. It goes back to the time of Confucius. So for thousands of years, it's been one way, where you had a tutor, a student. And all of a sudden, we're talking about using big data and AI. So help us really understand what's different. How is your service really different using big data or AI than what was there maybe just 10 years ago? And if, you know, help me understand. Do you want to start?
反正在学而思网校，我想我们利用大数据还有 AI 呢，我们主要还是以辅助老师为主，就是老师跟学生的关系还是这个教学跟被教学的一个这样的关系。但是因为有这个 AI 和大数据的赋能呢，对老师的要求以及是说对老师的效率会有非常大的提高，对老师的要求呢会有所降低。那原来老师我们可能要他要是无所不能的，或者是说他是要知道非常非常多的东西才能做到，但是呢现在呢可能因为有科技的手段，就能包括这个 AI 跟大数据啊，它能让这个老师，原来老师可能一个老师教十几个学生可能是已经是他的极限了，但是现在呢对我们来说一个老师可以教成百上千个学生，另外呢学生得到的体验以及他的学习效果呢能基本上比跟以前差不多，甚至比以前更好。所以这块是我自己的一些理解，就是这个我们在 AI 跟大数据的这种支持下呢，能把老师的效率变得更高。那我想举个例子，比如说这个我们现在这个老师，我们的英语口语课啊，其实现在已经是通过这个语音识别技术能让老师比如说老师问一个英语的问题，那所有的那个学生来回答。但是这个回答呢，原来在我们原来的情况下，我们只能做一对一或者一对几的一个反馈因为老师听不过来这么多学员的一个反馈但是呢因为我们有语音的评测技术以及识别技术呢，我们就能判断哪个孩子讲的是对的，哪个孩子讲的是更好的，然后我们通过机器给他反馈。虽然还是一个这个师生互动的一个过程，但是因为有了机器的加入呢，一个老师的口语课他可以同时给几百个学生同时上，但是每个学生呢都会收到他自己个性化的反馈，这样他就能增加这个老师的一个效果大概是这样的情况。谢谢。
So Ningyu, you're essentially, the argument you're making is that the technology is helping you be much more productive, more efficient, and scale. How about you, Simba? Is that similar to how you're using it, or do you have a different dimension of performance?
我相信原理是完全一样的， 就是任何的技术是为了业务服务，然后我们的任何的技术的开发都是为了让效率更高，成本更低。然后就是我们换一种方式来讲，就是说大侠辈出的年代，英雄辈出的年代，都是民众很不幸，民众很幸福的时候，都是没有什么太多英雄的这个年代。然后我们来重新来理解一下这个意思啊，是说其实你去看到，如果你今天整天听到这里名师那里名师在教育这里面，其实代表着一个东西是说，因为名师很稀缺，所以普通民众享受到这个服务非常困难。今天任何的技术的目标都是为了让名师不再稀缺。我来给大家举一个例子，是说我们平均一个晚上大概收到十几万条来自于学生发起的有付费的，然后来问一下这个题目是什么样子的，其中大概有7000到8000条左右是竞赛类的题目。大家知道竞赛类的题目可能会非常的难，普通老师是没有这个能力去 handle 处理的，但是学生有这种需求。通过我们的后台的分发的这个数据，我们可以把一道题目是代数还是几何，是数学还是物理先分清楚，分完清楚之后是代数还是几何分清楚，分清楚是你是解析几何，你的难度是一个求三角圆锥曲线的特殊值的一种方法，这种方法只在高考的少数的情况里面跟自主招生里面用到过，机器可以算出来这个事情，看明白这个事情，然后分发给一个北师大附中的晚上在那里讲课的一个老师，他可以很轻易的把这道题目讲明白，普通老师是没有这个能力讲的。我们瞬间可以把这个效率拉高到这样的一个程度，当我们能拉高到这种程度的时候，我们让知识获得变成了一个普及，滴滴的普及是让我们在交通资源上获得的普及，但我们的这个技术让教育的资源变成了更平等，所以它除了效率之外，更大的一个提升的是你愿意付一点点的成本，你可以把平等性拉得非常好。
Yeah, how about you, Drew?
Yeah, so based on what I understood from the translation, I'd say that what you guys are doing is much more about scale and you know, bringing price point down, accessibility, in some ways democratization of this service. And while we're doing some of that, I think you could argue what we're doing is kind of on the opposite side of the spectrum, in that the way we're deploying our data is about relevancy. And so for us, I'll give you an example. You know, you can match a tutor. So here's an example that actually I've always liked. So we had a parent who had a student that was struggling in math, and this student, it was a boy, he hated school, he tried everything, and the parents were at their wits' end. And using Wyzant, and this was a few years ago before we actually layered in a lot of this intelligence, but I think it still speaks to the point, this kid loved hockey, right? So they were able to find a tutor who played hockey in college, and now is a trader. He worked in finance, but he was still tutoring some math on the side. And he was able to use work, so the kid actually responded really well to this tutor. He was able to bring examples to bear that were very specific, that resonated with this kid about, you know, the angles and penalty minutes and coefficient. Ultimately, they ended up working on physics too, the coefficient of friction between the puck and the ice. And all these things that really resonated with this particular student because of relevancy. So what we're doing now is one of the sources of data that's really interesting for us is the feedback that we get from parents and students after each lesson. And they talk about that this particular tutor was very patient, he used real-world examples, and we're able to apply some language processing to these reviews. We get thousands of these every day. And then we're able to kind of pull out you know, these key attributes and help other parents who are looking for something very specific you know, really match on a much more granular level. And the way we present these tutors is all dynamic. So if we know that you're looking for something in particular, we'll be able to surface that in the search results and the tutor profile. So we're just creating these hyper-relevant experiences.
Okay, so let me take a vote, okay? You can't look at each other. Everyone has to answer individually. With all this data and AI, has the quality of the tutors gone up or down? Has it gone up or down? Has it gone up?
Definitely up. Yeah, definitely.
How about you? Has it gone up?
Of course.
So if I'm a tutor, it's going to be very difficult to become a tutor now. No? Or maybe not?
应该这么讲，它变轻松了。我来给大家举一个例子啊，是说，中国大概有1400万的中小学的老师，其中900万人没有获得过大学本科以上的学历，这个大家知道。然后我们大概测试过我们所有用来，给我们准备讲课的初级的一些 level 的这些老师，绝大部分人在高考体系里面来，一张150分的理科卷子很难考到90分以上。然后这就是我们在日常接受的这个教育的这实际的这个情况。但是今天我可以让他，一个晚上一直只在答立体几何类的这个问题，他可以在2个月的这个时间之内，见到他历史上20年教学里面所有比还要多的立体几何类型的所有的题目以及各种各样的学生的错法。他可以在2个月的时间里面迅速成为立体几何方面的绝对的专家，2个月，这可以做到。所以他是在让分工变细，他是在让人变得更专业、更垂直。所以你问我他是变难了还是变简单了，我认为入门变简单了，但是他要成为一个专家变得越来越难。他未来可能，如果他不是非常非常努力，说把中学数学的7个大方向、22个章节、550个知识点全部都来一遍的话，他可能很难成为一个顶尖的数学老师。
So is it easier to enter but harder to stay? Is that what you're saying? Or is it also hard to enter?
不是很难留下，他是非常容易进入，非常这很容易进入，但是他要成为一个绝对的专家，就全能型的选手。过去以前一个数学老师可以教全部的数学，我数学里面的每一块点。但是未来可能我们会出现一个只懂理科的理科，就是说几何的数学的老师。
Yeah, I would just add on that. I completely agree. I think the barrier is no higher to becoming a tutor, at least in our market. But there's much more specialization that occurs to that point that you're not going to have somebody that's an expert in everything. And I think with online tutoring, removing the geographic constraint, now you're able to match across, outside of geographic borders. So you can be much more granular and specific. You can be a specialist. And then the other thing, for us at least, the data has brought a lot of accountability. It's very easy to identify tutors who, on our marketplace, are not performing based on certain metrics around sort of response rate, conversion, retention, all these things that we look at real time in order to identify tutors that perhaps aren't meeting the standard. So there's definitely more accountability.
How about you? I know Xueersi was one of the pioneers. So what is your view on this?
对，我非常同意刚才那个Kailei那个观点，就是未来的教学肯定是分工越来越明确，分工越来越细。所以说原来比如说是一个老师是一个本科生，对吧？他在教学，但是未来可能就是他在某一个方面他就是一个博士。因为现在比如说在Xueersi网校，我们可能首先会把授课跟辅导给他做一个分工，就有的老师他可能是表现力特别特别好，对吧？他所以呢他就负责授课，他就负责讲课单向的这个知识传递。但有的老师呢他比较耐心，或者说他在某一方面他能做到那个因材施教，那他就来做这种个性化的这种辅导的工作。那个性化辅导呢，我们可能还会再分工，比如说未来会有专门负那个像Kailei说的专门负责这个立体几何的这样的老师，个性化辅导，还会有专门负责这个比如说线性代数的这样的一些，把它的分工呢会分得越来越细，所以整体来看呢，因为专业的分工啊，就导致就是比如说在某一个方面它的那个特别优秀的或者说研究的特别深的这些人出现。
Okay, but let's go to the next stage. So up to now you're talking about using data and AI to help all tutors be betterBut as you're talking about some of the tutors specializing, and I know, Simba, you created this Gaokao, robot.
Yeah.
So maybe we don't even need some of those. You have 30,000 tutors. Maybe we don't need some of those tutors if you have this robot. Do you believe in that world? I mean, the next stage would be not to make the existing tutors better, but just to, reduce some of the tutors.
到 今天为止我们看不到强人工智能的突破。我们今年在我们的做了一个高考机器人，参加了今年的高考，在数学的理科卷里面考到了134分的这个成绩，这基本上已经达到了一个顶尖的学生的大概这样的水平，大概一本考一本线是没有任何问题的这个成绩。但是呢，就是说是我们应该在明年会让这个系统再参加一次高考，应该在整个理科体系里面都可以全线达到一个考清华北大的这个水平的这个一个机器人就可以出现了。但是呢，就是说是我们做机器人做 AI 并不是为了干掉老师，坦率的讲我们看不到任何干掉老师的这个机会。事实上作为老师我们做教育的很清楚，是说它是传道授业解惑，但其实这里面没写着说负责要批卷子，然后那个叫什么找题目，然后给备课件。但其实这些活才是老师今天干的最多的，反而不是传道授业解惑，就他既不传道也没花多少时间授业，解惑更是寥寥无几，但他花了太多时间批作业准备也课件跟找题目。我们今天让这机器来干这个事情，我们希望老师回归到传道授业解惑的这里面的这个本质，而不是每天无穷无尽的去批这个东西。所以我们自己认为是说机器的出现或者说数据的出现是为了赋能老师，让老师成为超级老师。原来我们的中医只有一个招搭脉，然后望闻问切结束了。今天我们希望把现代医学引到现代技术，引到传统的教学里面去。我们希望为今天的教育开发出来 CT 核磁共振 MR 等一系列的这种工具，帮助老师更好的去观察学生理解学生，而不是凭望闻问切来做任何的这个决定。望闻问切本来也就挺累的，这才是我们觉得说机器能干的事情。
对我们来说，其实我们也曾经想过，如果机器都能取代老师，那老师来做什么？当然我觉得可能在未来，比如说假设是几百年后，可能会出现一个 AI 的机器人，它会达到一个老师的水平。但我觉得至少在现阶段嘛，包括教育行业，包括这个医疗行业，我觉得都是最后被 AI 代替的这个行业。就如果大部分行业都被 AI 代替了，可能最后才会轮到教育。因为我们发现教育这个行业啊，它其实并不仅仅是说你能解题就行，或者甚至是说你能发现错误，这个东西都不是最核心的。我们发现呢，教育呢，因为后来有一个这个教育理念，我们叫激发兴趣、培养习惯、塑造品格，它很多的时候呢，它其实并不是说你知识够了就能解决老师的问题。就是孩子为什么有兴趣呢？很多时候是因为老师的关注，他需要一个真人的关注，而不是一个机器的关注。因为我们之前也尝试过，最早Xueersi网校呢，我们做录播课。但是那个录播它的效果，因为不像是一个真人的关注，虽然我们也做互动题，我们也做比如说那个学生之间可以竞赛可以 PK， 但是我们发现呢，学生他就是不学，就是我们整个录播课的完成率呢可能只有30%左右。但是我们改成直播的时候，其实上的内容你说有没有特别大的变化，其实也没有特别大的变化，但是因为是真人，因为他能感受到老师的存在，能感受到这是一个真人给他的关注，他一下子这个体验呢，参与的就会高得非常多。所以我其实我也比较赞同这个观点，就是未来呢，就在未来的很长一段时间内，我们可能解决的就是帮助老师，就是像给医生提供这个验血结果啊，给这个 CT 核磁共振结果这种方式来帮助老师，让老师的效率越来越高。但是呢 ，AI 在很长的一段时间内，我觉得应该都不能解决这个人类这个老师这个问题。
Did you have a point of view on this as well?
I think it was pretty well covered. I think for certain, maybe more like homework help applications where I'm just looking for a quick solution, we're already seeing this, right? Photo math, even Wolfram Alpha has been around for a long time. So that's going to continue. But when it comes to the high impact, long-term relationship-based, whether it's remediation or kind of mastery of a particular discipline, that, like I said before, we know that how important the match is, right? Which suggests that the nuance of the relationship and the ability of humans to connect with one another in this inherently social way is crucial. So to think that a robot is going to be able to get that nuanced, I agree, you know, like what that sort of stuff you're talking about, you said, I think you said hundreds of years, but it's well out there. But I think the lower order aspects of tutoring, whether it's the broadcasting of the information or some of the rote like practice, you know, I want to talk, you could theoretically talk to a robot to practice a language, or you could have a bot that would teach you your multiplication table, some of that stuff. Is going to, I don't know if cannibalize is the right word, but it's going to get replaced. But I think what we're talking about is really that kind of relationship-based kind of coaching motivation. I think that's going to be a long time out.
Yeah, but you know, I guess if I were to summarize the three of you, you're talking a lot about using data to specialize the role of the tutor. So maybe the extreme of replacing the tutor isn't in the near future, but you are talking a lot about separating the different roles from somebody who can really teach the content to somebody who can motivate the students and using data in order to make a better match for that. And I think it's a, I guess the one thought I have is it's an open question as to whether or not that's going to increase the number of people who can be good tutors or decrease the number of people who can be good tutors. In other words, will fewer tutors make, you know, be in greater demand, or will everybody get more business, you know, have more work? So that's a question. I don't know if you have a point of view on that, whether it's going to, you know, concentrate the demand to few people or spread it out.
我觉得未来啊，在老师这个行业里头，我觉得现阶段至少在中国吧，我觉得老师的数量应该是不够的。特别是在那个，就是即使比如说老师的效率越来越高，但是我们整体的老师的数量，包括我们在二三线城市甚至农村啊，其实我们的整体老师数量不够的。我们在小学可能一个老师会教好几门课，所以我认为呢，在短期之内我们肯定是要增加老师的数量，但是未来会不会出现比如说因为效率的提升啊，老师的数量开始减少，我觉得是有可能，是有可能的。但是呢，有可能是比如说特定的科目，但是我觉得未来的教学啊，可能不会只是说在中国比如说就是语数外这个或者物理化学这些科目，未来我觉得还会有一些这个就比如说像科学啊，包括这种比如说像理财啊，像类似的这样的一些学科呀，它会起来。那这些学科呢，它可能就需要更多的老师。另外，包括一些专业的方向，它可能也需要更多的老师。所以我觉得，如果从单一学科来看呢，我觉得有可能因为效率的提升，老师的数量在减少。当然，我觉得整体的老师数量呢，随着学科的增加，有可能老师数量还会增加。
Drew, you've seen that in your business, right?
Yeah, I think our marketplace is a kind of a good example where our business is growing, the number of students is going up, but in the last few years with the prevalence of online tutoring, the tutors are able to be, you know, have more impact and more leverage, so the number of tutors is going down, just based on that's more of a move to online versus in person, just utilization and efficacy is higher. But yeah, I agree that at the same time, it's going to open up. I think that, you know, it's going to broaden the scope of tutoring. So I don't know how that nets out, but certainly tutors are going to have, an individual tutor will have more leverage and the ability to impact more students as, you know, this technology continues to improve.
教育是一个相对在马斯洛需求里面更高一层的需求。伴随经济的增长，教育整体是需求是在不断的在往上升的。我来给大家举这样一个例子，是说我们来可以算一算到底它的变多还是变少。比如我们今年进了西藏的拉萨中学，然后做了这样的一套东西，你可以理解为是双师。然后人大附中的老师可以在人大附中直接教西藏的拉萨中学的这个学生，一个班一个老师可以教两个班，同时人大附中跟拉萨的两个班。原因非常简单，就是拉萨地区的老师非常优秀，老师急缺，他们的平均高考数学成绩可能只有几十分， 平均，这是最好的学校，然后只有几十分，他们的整体情况很差。然后当地的教育厅厅长看到了这个系统之后，希望是说能在整个拉萨铺设，然后整个西藏铺设，希望用一代人的时间彻底让内陆地区的孩子能够接受到拉萨地区的孩子能接受到内陆的这个教育。你看起来在减少，但实际上它不是减少，它没有任何减少，就是说当地的老师在得到了人大附中的老师的培训之后，发起了更进一步的培训的需求，并且开始往下面一部分是说原来没有覆盖到的一些学生开始进行渗透，他们开始担任起了助教老师的工作，并且把很多原来没有办法教的一些科目给开起来了，在理科体系里面开起来了。所以我们现在认为是说任何一个今天的所有技术的往前进都会激发更大量的教育的本身的这个需求，所以我们看不到老师在减少的这种可能性。而我们认为在这个过程中只会当市场越开发越成熟的时候，越来越多人加入到教育本身这个行业，所以我们觉得老师的数量正在增加，这是一个整体在爆发的行业。
OK, so let's shift gears because I know there are some entrepreneurs in the audience, and I know one of the things that I'm very curious about is to learn how you decided what data to use and what's really important. So, you know, there's a saying that our sector is data rich, but information poor, meaning we have so much data, but it's very difficult to know which ones to use. So as you were collecting all this data, how did you go about figuring out what would be the most useful? What metrics or success factors did you use to figure that out? Do you want to start?
好的，我觉得那个，因为我原来是在这个互联网行业做那个搜索啊，或者做广告这个行业，我就发现这个人工智能跟大数据啊，在这个不同行业里头，就是使用时候呢，还是有非常大的差别。因为在互联网行业呢，比如说在广告行业，它有一个非常非常明确的指标，就是我在优化这个点击率，点击率，包括这个转化效率，就是那个用户付费购买的这个效率，所以它有一个非常非常明确的一个目标。所以这个大数据的这个应用场景是非常明确的，所以在这种行业呢，这个大数据的这个应用啊，它其实是就是基本上就是完全代替人了，就是搜索引擎和广告这个在线广告基本上是完全是用大数据跟人工智能来实现的。但在这教育行业呢，虽然我们也产生了大量的数据，但是我们有一点就是跟这种纯互联网行业一个非常大的区别，就是它的优化目标不那么明确。什么叫优化目标不那么明确呢？就是比如说互联网行业我们在优化点击率，但是呢在这个教育行业呢，其实我们核心的优化，比如说我们优化的是孩子的能力的提升，对吧？他可能是他的学习能力的提升，包括他或者说他是假设如果我们再退一步嘛，是他的解题能力的提升，或者说他这个知识是不是掌握了。那这个东西呢在我们这个行业特别难评估，我们特别能拿到这种有效的数据，我们拿到的都是这种过程的数据，就是孩子做了多少道题，对了多少题，错了多少题，他花了多少时间，就这种数据我们能拿到，但是呢，他到底是进步了还是退步了，他到底是不是实际上掌握了这个能力呢？我们是很难拿到的。所以我觉得我们在整个这个教育行业呢，我们在这个数据的利用上，确实是像刚才Kim 所说的，就是我们 data 很多，但是 information 很少。在网校呢，我们目前在尝试一个方式呢，就是我们通过，因为我们确实不知道孩子的能力提升，因为能力提升，比如说他甚至通过考试都没办法，确定，比如说因为人是没办法同时进入，两次同时进入一条河流的，你也不能判断他两次考试是因为他自己的，因为考试题目的变化，或者是说他现在状态的变化导致成绩的波动，还是他真正学会了，所以我们只能短期呢来确定他这个一个知识点是不是彻底学会。那我们目前做了一个实验，就是孩子在课前跟课后，我们分别给他做一个测试，这是同类题型的一个测试。我们来看呢，这同类题型呢，他到底是进步了还是退步了。然后呢，我们来反推他在课堂上，比如说我们老师的给他的讲授方法，因为不同的老师可能会用稍微有一些差异的讲授方法来讲授，包括不同的辅导老师呢，会有不同的批改方式来给他批改。我们通过这个成绩的差异呢，来反推我们的这个讲授方法跟这个批改方式是不是正确的。通过这种方式来逐步的优化我们的讲授跟批改，当然这只是我们一个比较小的一个尝试， 如果我们所以我想表达就是在整个教育行业怎么探索这个数据来驱动这个整个教学场景呢，其实还是比较难的一件事情。
我来说一下我们干几件事啊，因为我们是一个被认为是一个技术公司，所以那个我们大概做了几个东西试图把它给做好。第一个是我们主要在 focus 在中学的理科，所以我们把手写识别给做好了，然后再加上我们自己特制的这个硬件，所以我们的能力是有能力采集学生的所有书写轨迹的，就是他们在每一秒钟他可以采集120次啊，然后所以我能采集他的所有的书写轨迹，并且可以把它给全部复原回来。所以呢我们今天我们自己感觉就是说是整个教育行业还处在一个传统医学的这种感觉过程中，还没有进入到现代医学。现代医学是发明了就是细胞啊，所有发现了细胞啊，所有这一系列事情，以及手段开始有了验血、核磁共振的一系列其他技术的，就发现了之后才突飞猛进到今天的。我们今天先把一个技术先给做好，就是说我能复原学生的笔记，我能复原他做的这个题目。当我手里面有他的题目的信息，非常便自动化能够识别这些信息的时候，我手里面有他的书写的轨迹的这些信息，然后并且我能把它也翻译为机器能理解的语言的时候，我们把这两个核心信息拿到的时候，我们复原了主要场景。但是我还是想强调是说，我们现在不明白很多东西，比如说我们可以分出来两类都是考65分的孩子，但是我们现在很明确知道他们是不一样的。比如说不一样在点在哪里，就是我告诉你这一个孩子他考65分是因为他一个小时因为他的耐心有问题，然后他一个小时之后就开始出现大量的错误，不管什么题都错，他耐心有问题。这个孩子考65分是因为他阅读能力有问题，就是他复杂一点的题目，就是说题目跟知识点无关，跟复杂那语言的描述难度有关系，以及他的那个就是基础的语料信息如果复杂一点他就会丢分。但是我不知道他是怎么造成的，这些信息都是我不知道的。所以这就是我们所说的，我们有很多数据，但是我们只能把这数据反推给人，但是老师是可以弄明白这件事情的，说他的哪些训练依然不够，所以应该补充什么东西，哪些学习依然有问题，所以应该补充什么东西。所以这就是我印证了我刚才所说的，到今天为止机器不能代替人，我们不知道孩子是从哪一刻开始这个能力丢失了或者没有被培养起来，但是老师知道了这些信息之后，老师是能够去改变学生的。这就是为什么说我们一直所说的，说我们今天干的本质上就是 CT 机核磁共振，我们给医生给老师一个很好的报告，说来你来做决定，动手术还是吃药，这就是我们真正在干的事情。
Hey, Drew, I mean you have a marketplace, so what is your sense about the data that you need to collect in order to turn it into useful information?
I think the collection of the data, maybe 6+ years ago, that was a thing. I think now it's, you know, you can assume that everything's collected. That's just like basic best practice. So it's more just what do we do with this? And you can't just start with, here's a pile of data, let me try to make some sense of it. You got to start with a hypothesis or a problem or a specific thing you're trying to optimize for. So you sort of have to invert how you think about it. One of the examples that is pretty recent for us is we recently started, we rolled out a feature that allows people to record and play back their online lessons so that you don't have to take notes, right, while you're having, you know, your lesson. You can just go back and watch it. And it's just a gold mine of data. So we've started, with people's permission, transcribing these lessons, and we're able to see some very immediate trends. Like statistics is a very common subject for us. So we knew we were having lots of statistics lessons, but by transcribing and processing the actual words that are occurring, we're able to see an inordinate amount of time being spent on hypothesis testing, which is just one subtopic within statistics. And we're also able to see that within 4 or 5 lessons, a lot of these people are going to be struggling with regression analysis. So we can sort of get out ahead of that. And the whole thing we were trying to optimize for is how do we provide better recommendations and get out ahead of people having another problem based on the data we have. So yeah, but it's every word, every click, every page that you land on. I mean, everything is captured. I think most companies are doing that now. So it's infinite. And that is the challenge, is trying to sort through that.
So
my belief is that in order for data to be turned into very useful information, you need to have a closed loop. In other words, the data that you collect has to also then be used for teaching. And then the teaching has to result in student results that you can also collect that can be then fit back in. So, you know, the companies that I think will win, I'm going to make a statement and see if you agree. Do you agree that companies that will win in this sector using big data and AI will be ones that can collect the information, then use that information for teaching that can result in more information and go back and forth? The implication of this is that schools will have a difficult time because they only capture data, you know, from the morning and night. They can't capture data, for example, at home. Whereas companies like yours, each of yours, you have academic data, behavioral data, all sorts of data that you can capture. Do you agree with that statement, or do you think it's still wide open?
Sure.
Yeah. How about you? Do you agree with that thesis?
你是说这个，如果我们就有的公司可以收集到学习的数据，然后再反馈到教学，然后再收集到更多的数据，形成这样一个闭环。
Yeah. Yeah. And they can collect also behavioral data. You know.
在家的。
Right. At home, as well as outside of the school.
这个数据我觉得相对来说，相对来说是比较难的。当然现在我们其实是我们这个目前在中国，我觉得这个产业它其实分成好几块的，比如说像Xueersi网校，我们主要是负责课外辅导的，包括那个线下班的辅导。那课内的学习呢，包括这个作业，比如说像学霸君，他可能会有像搜题。那包括像作业盒子、一起作业这种公司呢，它可能会，比如说它负责这个，就是它进另外一个产业，比如说进公立校，包括那个学霸君现在也在进公立校，就它这个产业，我认为我们目前在整个就学生这个教学数据的收集上，其实整个行业，可能是不同的公司如果联合起来，它可能形成了一个闭环。但是呢，目前为止，我觉得我们倒没有任何一个企业单独呢，它能形成一个完整的。这是我们目前这个我认为暂时还没有，但是如果真的能做到这一点，就是他能把整个学生的学习流程从他课外辅导到校内到在家的这个学习啊全部都能打通起来，那他肯定是一个非常非常有效的一个那个自循环体系，通过收集到更多的数据能做到一个更好的反馈。
But do you think people will want to share data? Will this only end up with a few companies having enough data to really be able to make it useful? Or do you think this is something where everybody will share?
我认为如果对孩子的学习有帮助，对孩子的成长有帮助，那个我们未来应该会有包括公司包括个人，他会愿意把这个东西都share出来。但是我觉得暂时我还没看到
Simba, what do you think?
Never happen. Come on, 这是 business. 就大家清楚一点，这是 business. 然后如果有人拿到了海量的本身的学习数据，除了用 M&A 的方式来完成这种数据的采集之外，我不太相信是说在商业的这个环境里面能够构建起，因为它本身很难进行度量，也在一个会计层面它是不可靠计量的时候它就不可能发生，所以我觉得对于 business 来说很难发生，除非有国家级别的引导，但是我们都知道国家级别的引导效率都意味着非常可疑。
Yeah, I don't know what it's like here, but in the US there's just so much talk about data privacy with students, that an ecosystem where it gets shared around across businesses and between businesses and schools sounds unrealistic, at least at this stage.
what do you think? Your panelists are saying that it'll never happen, and you have a more generous view of human nature.
我是觉得就是如果，当然我首先我觉得这个确实是很难的一件事情，就是在商业上很难的一件事情。当然它可能需要一个足够强的一个主导，比如说是国家或者是政府啊，或者是说在某一个区域，它形成这样的闭环。当然我也同意了，至少在短期之内确实是很难看到这个趋势。
One of the implications of this is that means that there will only be a few winners in AI and big data then. That, you know, the only a few companies can have enough to make it useful. Because I think a little bit of data is useless.
Yeah.
You need to have a sufficient amount. Do you agree with that? Do you think that that's going to be the case? Right now the field is still open, but in a few years, it's going to be very difficult. It's a little bit like the search business. If you have more data, then you win in search. If you have only a few, it's very difficult to break in. Do you believe that that's the case?
我觉得在教育这个领域，其实教育跟 search 还是有一个非常大的一个区别，就是教育我们看起来是一个教育的市场，比如说我们认为教育是个万亿的市场，但是教育还是细分的，就是我们认为比如说像语文、数学、英语，甚至语文、数学、英语都是细分的。我们未来我觉得很有可能包括那个成人教育，包括各种各样的学科，它其实是一个细分的领域，如果我们仔细去研究，它可能不是一个通用的领域。所以我认为啊，如果这个数据在某一个特定的领域它形成足够多的密度啊，或者是这个浓度啊，它可能自己就能产生一个非常大的一个价值啊，当然它可能需要在单个领域产生一个巨大的一个数据量啊，所以我觉得当然就是数据量肯定是越大，当然它也不一定是越大越好，我觉得应该是就是有价值的数据，有标注的数据，有目的性的数据啊，这种数据越多肯定会越好。当然我觉得在单个领域是很容易形成寡头，在单个领域是会形成比如说我们就说考研，或者说我们就说四六级考试，那有可能它就会形成单个寡头，包括 GRE 托福考试。
教育那个在中国有句话，是一个一厘米宽一公里深的赛道，就是都是沟，到处都是坑，然后都是一厘米宽一公里深，你随便踩一下，你以为踩的是两个不同的坑，一个坑，但对不起，这是两个完全不同的坑。然后我们现在看到的情况就是，你问我会不会出现最后大家上的是同一个培训班的，整个中国上几个培训班，不可能，永远不会发生。但你问我说有没有可能最后你的所有的数据在少数几个公司的手里面真正掌握着，完全有可能。就是这是一个巨大的分发性的这个行业，但是所有的从业者正在做使劲或有意或者无意的在做一件事情，就是在尽量的使教学数据结构化。这件事情已经很多很多人在用同一种方式做了，并且已经在默默无闻的过去的五年里面，有一堆人已经被落下了，剩下了一批能干这个事情的这人。所以我们觉得再过五年，教学数据的结构化这件事情可能会被少数的一些公司真正的所掌握。那么在这个时候，你可以理解为说它可能是一个巨大的分发的一个平台，然后你的所有的，你可能在 ABCD 七家学培训机构里面上过课，但是背后的数据跟行为是来有一家进行存储跟分发，这是完全可能的，没有任何问题。然后它比较像是说你在七个淘宝店买了东西，但是淘宝知道你所有的交易数据，或者是京东知道你所有的交易数据，你在多少家买东西不重要，重要的是它能够分析你，所以这件事情是我认为一定会出现的。
Yeah, Drew, I'm here. I want to hear your thoughts, but just before we go there, you know, this is the behavior that we call, like a business school, that the winner take most. You know, so there's a question of whether or not that's the way that the market dynamics are working. But Drew, what are your thoughts?
Well, I was just going to say, I mean, we're talking about big data and you know, the winner take all, winner take most type mechanics. But at the end of the day, I think education is going to be the last industry. You talk about search, like in this case, we have people interacting with people. So we're going to be able to surround that with a lot of intelligence and data. But I don't think it's going to be an aggregated type market. I think even medicine, which is often compared to education, will move in that direction before education, just because it's more than information, right? We just kind of come full circle. It's about motivation, it's about guidance, it's about coaching, and that's why, you know, I think learning is always going to have a big social component. So
I guess I could make the countervailing argument that if we have a tension here, if you want true innovation in AI, you actually need a few companies to own a lot of data, because the data that is distributed will not be that useful for any one player. On the other hand, if you want a more democratized version of the world, then maybe it'll slow down the development of big data and AI, but there'll be more players. So that's what we need to see. That's the future. So we just have a few more minutes, what I thought I would do is give each of you an opportunity to just say a few words, close out, advice for others pursuing this path. This is obviously a very popular and, an area of great deal of interest. So any final advice or thoughts, things you would recommend the people not do, things of that nature that you want to say, and then we'll close it out. Shall we start with you? Just any recommendations about this sector for the audience? Final words?
Okay. 我觉得这个是一个非常有前景的行业，因为毕竟教育是一个巨大的行业。所以呢，我觉得可能虽然我们目前没有哪家机构，我们可以说我们在这个方面，就像搜索引擎，包括就是类似的这样的行业，我们已经用得非常好。但我觉得可能它需要大家一起来探索，可能不仅仅是这个就是寡头的事情，或者说单一几家机构的事情。
其实我想先回应一下你刚才说。希望数据尽快聚集的这个事情，其实，尽快聚集对于普通的公众并不有利。这个游戏刚刚开始，然后更适合让它再发展一段时间。坦率的讲，今天在教育上需要得到的开发的这个技术还并没有被全面的开发出来。我们大概罗列过超过有100项以上的细分领域的各种各样的技术，我们知道它应该被做出来，但是它没有。然后所以在这样的这情况之下，意味着一个非常重要的事情是，现在容忍小公司是非常非常重要的一件事情。所以我如果给任何建议的话，我会给说，教育真的是个非常传统的东西，技术在这里面能改变的是极其有限的，就技术一定要为业务所服务，或者为教育所服务，这件事情才是对的。所以总的来说，我认为慢慢来比较快。
Yeah, just I think the two concepts to leave with are specialization. Everybody learns differently. Everybody has different circumstances. Everybody has different needs. Everybody has different goals. And I think AI, big data is going to help us bring that to bear better than ever before. It already is. And then the other one is democratization. I really think I get asked all the time about tutoring. Is that in some ways are you... exacerbating the differences between the haves and the have-nots, right? The people that have resources can afford tutors and they can, they have an unfair advantage. And I think there's real potential here, to change that equation and to improve access and, level the playing field with AI.
Well, certainly this is an exciting time where incredible amount of data is being used to both improve the efficiency and the productivity of teachers, as well as improve the learning of students, to use Drew's words, to democratize the opportunities for all people. So I want to thank the panelists for, all three of you are true innovators and entrepreneurs in this area, so thank you very much for sharing your thoughts with us. please join me in thanking them for being on the panel today. And this wraps up our session. Thank you very much.